great to see you. Thank you for taking the time to be here. How many of you are coming to hear me at a town hall for the first time? Well, where have y'all been? It's good to see you. I'm glad that you could be here. It's great to be back in Iowa. You know, I was born and raised in a small rural town in South Carolina. 2,500 people, two stoplights. You couldn't think about doing something wrong without somebody already telling you wrong. I actually grew up playing on a cotton field and at a dairy farm. And so I very much, when I come to Iowa, there's a sense of peace because it feels like where I grew up. My parents started a business out of the living room of our home. 30 plus years later, it was a successful company. I started doing the books for the family business when I was 13. It wasn't until I got to college that I realized that was child labor. I'm not an Ivy Leaguer. I went to a public university. I went to Clemson University, go Tigers, and graduated with a degree in accounting. Accountants are problem solvers. And then I went on and worked in the corporate world. And then I came back home to the family business. And one day I happened to be sitting with my mom, telling her how hard it was to make a dollar and how easy it was for government to take it. And my mom said, quit complaining about it, do something about it. I truly did not know you weren't supposed to run against a 30-year incumbent in a primary. Ignorance is bliss. Once I realized he was related to half the district, the only option was to win. So I went around the district and I said, there are way too many lawyers at the state house. I think they need a really good accountant. And they took a chance on me and we won. When I got to the state house, my focus really was on fighting for small businesses. I think small businesses are the heartbeat of our economy, and they needed a fighter. And so for a few years, that was my focus. But South Carolina, we typically vote on things by voice vote. All in favor, say aye. All opposed, nay. The ayes have it. But one day, they pushed through a bill that would give legislators a pay raise. All in favor, say aye. All opposed, silence. The ayes have it, yet to this day, you can't find anyone that says they voted themselves a pay raise. I was furious. We had a Republican House, a Republican Senate, and a Republican governor. And so I filed a bill that said anything important enough to be debated on the floor of the House or the Senate is important enough for people to know how their legislators voted. And the Speaker of the House said, put the bill away. We don't need to have it. People decide what the public needs to see and what they don't. Long story short, when I wouldn't put the bill away, and when I fought for that, they stripped me of everything. I lost all my seniority. They took me off my committee assignments. I could take the well. No one would hear me speak. I could sponsor a bill. No one would co-sponsor. And so I ran for governor. And I'm proud to say one of the first bills I signed into law is now in South Carolina. Anything important enough to be debated on the floor of the House or the Senate is now showing every legislative vote on the record for everyone to see. And we took it a step further, and we did it on every section of the budget as well. And I love music. You were listening to my playlist earlier. And so on the day of the bill signing, we blasted throughout the State House. Pat Benatar's Hit Me With Your Best Shot. When I became governor, South Carolina was hurting. We had 11% unemployment. We had thousands of people on welfare, and South Carolina was the butt of jokes. And we got to work. By the time I left, that 11% unemployment went to 4%. We announced thousands of jobs all over the state in every county. We were building planes with Boeing. We were building more BMWs than any place in the world. We brought in Mercedes-Benz. We brought in Volvo, five international tire companies. They were referring to us as the beast of the Southeast, which I love. But we also did some things that were really important. We said, if you have to show picture ID to buy Sudafed, you have to show picture ID to get on a plane, you should have to show picture ID to protect the integrity of the election process. We passed voter ID in South Carolina. We passed one of the toughest illegal immigration laws in the country. We passed tort reform. And what we did is we cut taxes. We paid down our debt. We built up our coffers. And by the time I left, South Carolina was named the friendliest state in the country, the most patriotic state in the country, and the number two state in the country people were moving to. And then I got the call for the United Nations. And my honest answer was, I don't even know what the UN does. I just know everybody hates it. I was not wrong about that. But I went into the UN wanting countries to know what America was for and what America was against. I didn't care if they didn't like me, but I wanted them to respect America. And we got to work. We pulled ourselves out of the Iran deal. I pushed China and Russia to agree to 4 sets of sanctions that were the largest they had seen in a generation against North Korea to get them to stop testing ballistic missiles. We moved the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. But the best thing that we did, we took the kick me sign off of our backs, and America was respected again at the UN. Now I'm running for president, and I don't need to tell you how bad things are. You don't have to turn on the news to see it. You feel it when you go to the grocery store. You feel it when you fill your car up with gas. You feel it with your mortgage payment, your insurance payment. Everything that you have to have is more expensive. And I would love to tell you that Biden did that to us. But I've always spoken in hard truths, and I'm going to do that with you tonight. Our Republicans did that to us too. Biden has sent us down the socialism creek that's dangerous, and we need to stop it. But our Republicans passed that $2.2 trillion COVID stimulus bill with no accountability, that expanded welfare, that has now left us with 100 million Americans on Medicaid, 42 million Americans on food stamps. That's a third of our country. And did Republicans try and make it right? Nope. They opened up earmarks and pet projects for the first time in 10 years, pushing through 7,000 of them last December. Want to know how they spent your money? $30 million on an honors college in Vermont, $10 million to tear down a hotel in Alaska, $7.5 million on a courthouse in Colorado, and the list goes on. In the 2024 appropriations budget, Republicans put in $7.4 billion worth of pet projects and earmarks. Democrats put in $2.8 billion. So now you tell me who the big spenders are. All while 1 in 6 American families can't afford their utility bill, 60% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck, 50% of American families can't afford diapers, Social Security will go bankrupt in 10 years, Medicare will go bankrupt in 8. Then you look at our school system, and everybody wants to blame COVID for the situation we have in schools. We had problems with education before COVID. Do you know right now in America, only 31% of 8th graders are proficient in reading? 31%. Only 27% of 8th graders are proficient in math. If we don't do something, we're going to be in a world of hurt 10 years from now. And then I have lost words to talk about the border. It's reckless. It's irresponsible. I've said every word I know to say. But it's a total dereliction of duty. And I've been to the border, and I didn't pull a Kamala, go and come back. I went 400 miles down that border. You're not ready for what I saw. Mounds of clothes, mounds of shoes, paraphernalia, rape areas that the women and girls have to walk through. When you get up in the morning, you get your coffee and you watch the news. When these ranchers get up in the morning, they get their coffee and they go see if anybody died crossing the fence. They pick up whatever little kids were left behind and turn them over to Border Patrol. I met with multiple sheriffs. They said before 7 a.m., they round up whatever illegal immigrants they can find and turn them over to Border Patrol. Border Patrol documents them and releases them until their court date years from now. And when I asked Border Patrol about their job, they said, you want to know what we do? We're glorified babysitters. They don't let us do our job. 8 million illegal immigrants have crossed that border. We had enough fentanyl cross that border last year that would kill every single American. Number one cause of death for adults 18 to 45, fentanyl. And don't think for a second China doesn't know what they're doing when they send it over. And then my parents always taught me, you take care of those who take care of you. I'm going to ask you if we're taking care of those who take care of us. right now in America, 33,000 of our veterans are homeless. That we know of. One in three suffers from PTSD or thoughts of suicide. We lose 22 heroes a day to suicide. If a veteran needs a doctor's appointment, on average, it takes them 29 days to get an appointment at the VA. Why 29 days? Because on the 30th day, they can go to the doctor or hospital of their choice. So midway through the 29 days, they get a call to reschedule, and the clock starts all over again. It's shameful how we treat our veterans. That's a lot of bad, right? It's hard to find anything good. Don't you think it's finally time we had term limits in Washington, D.C.? Don't you think that it's finally time that we do mental competency tests for anyone over the age of 75? And let me tell you, I'm not being disrespectful when I say that. We all know people who can run circles around us that are above 75. I mean, look at Senator Grassley, good gracious, like he could do anything. But then we know Joe Biden. I don't care if it's for people 50 and up. But these are people making decisions on our national security. These are people making decisions on the future of our economy. We need to know they're at the top of their game. So that's a lot of bad, right? It's hard to find anything good. But now I'm going to tell you what I told South Carolinians when I became governor. No more whining. No more complaining. Now we get to work. How do we fix it? The first thing we do is let's look at the economy. We go and claw back the hundreds of billions of dollars of unspent COVID dollars that are out there. Instead of 87,000 IRS agents going after middle America, let's go after the hundreds of billions of dollars of COVID fraud. One out of every $7 was spent fraudulently. If 8% of our budget is interest, quit borrowing. Cut up the credit cards. You have to balance a budget every day. I had to balance a budget as governor. Why is Congress the only group that refuses to balance a budget? We'll stop the spending, we'll stop the borrowing, we'll eliminate the earmarks, and I will veto any spending bill that doesn't take us back to pre-COVID levels. That will save us trillions. And then we need to focus on the middle class. We are right now in America watching the rich get richer and the poor get poorer. We've got to open it up for the middle class. That's why I want to eliminate the federal gas and diesel tax in this country. I want to cut taxes on the middle class and simplify those brackets. And let's make the small business tax cuts permanent. They made corporate tax cuts permanent, but they made small business tax cuts temporary. Let's make those tax cuts permanent. That's when you'll get the economy moving again. And then I saw when I was governor, governors meet with their presidents once a year. I will meet with our governors once a quarter, Republican and Democrat, with the sole focus of taking as many federal programs as we can and push them down to the states. That way you're reducing the size of the federal government, but you're empowering people on the ground. That's how we'll get our economic situation back on track. When it comes to education, in South Carolina, we knew if a child couldn't read by third grade, they were four times less likely to graduate high school. So we started holding our kids back. We brought their parents in. We did reading remediation plans, and we set them up for success. We've got to do that all over our country. We have got to get our kids reading again, or we'll be in a world of hurt. And then, no parent should ever wonder what's being said or taught to their child in the classroom. We need complete transparency in the classroom. And every parent should be able to decide which school their child goes to. As a parent, you have one job. Every child deserves a good education, regardless of where they're born and raised. We have to stop mandating kids based on a zip code and start really setting them up for success. And then let's build things in America again. Let's put vocational classes back into our high schools. In South Carolina, we had apprenticeships all over our state. We taught our kids how to build the things we were making. That way they were invested in our economy before they even finished school. And then, as a point of personal privilege, and you strong moms, we have to raise strong girls. Strong girls become strong women. Strong women become strong leaders. That does not happen if you have biological boys playing in girls' sports. We've got to cut that out once and for all. I had a daughter that when she was in high school, she ran track. I don't even know how I would have that conversation with her about biological boys being in her locker room. How do you get them used to that? You can't. We've got to stop that altogether. And then when it came to the border, so I told you we passed one of the toughest illegal immigration laws in our state. We're going to take that national. We would do a national E-Verify program that would require businesses to prove that the people that they're hiring are in this country legally. The second thing is we will defund sanctuary cities once and for all. We have to stop that safe haven and that recklessness that's happening. We will put 25,000 Border Patrol and ICE agents on the ground and let them do their job. And we will go back to the Remain in Mexico policy so that they never even step foot in the U.S. in the first place. They have to process from there. And instead of catch and release, we'll go to catch and deport. That's how we'll deal with what's happening on the border. And then when it comes to our veterans, we always see, the cameras will show us the days that our men and women leave and the tears that are shed. And then we see the blessings of when they come back home to us safely and how happy we are. I'm the wife of a combat veteran. My husband deployed to Afghanistan. The day he came home was a blessing answered. But that was the easy part. When we got home, that's when life got hard. He couldn't hear loud noises. He couldn't be in crowds. Life had passed him by for the year that he was gone, and the transition was tough. We can't just love our men and women when they're gone. We got to love them when they come back home, too. So we've got to focus more on that transition and getting it right. We need to do telehealth so that they get the mental health care they need right when they need it. They should be able to go to the doctor or hospital of their choice. They've earned that right. And when it comes to their health care, I think a good way to deal with that is I think every member of Congress should have to get their health care from the VA. And you watch how fast that gets fixed. It would be the best health care you've ever seen, guaranteed. So those are the domestic issues. And we have what we need to do to get that on track. Now let's talk about national security. The world is on fire. You've got a war in Europe. You've got a war in the Middle East. You've got North Korea testing ballistic missiles. You've got China on the march. But make no mistake, none of that would have happened had we not had that debacle in Afghanistan. The idea that my husband and his military brothers and sisters who served there had to watch us leave Bagram Air Force Base in the middle of the night without telling our allies who stood shoulder to shoulder with us for decades because we asked them to be there. Think about what that told our friends. More importantly, think about what that told our enemies. And what do you have going on now in D.C.? You've got Congress telling you, do we support Ukraine or do we support Israel? Do we support Israel or do we close the border? Don't let them lie to you about that. That's not being honest. The truth is, you have to look at the bigger picture of what all of this means and how it affects America's national security. Let's take them one at a time. When you start with Ukraine, first of all, you should know, we had no better friend at the United Nations. They voted with us on everything. They showed up at every event that we did, even if we didn't ask them to. They were always there and were hugely pro-American. Here is this thug who invaded a freedom-loving, pro-American country. And 500,000 people have died because of Putin. have the people in Ukraine doing is fighting for their very survival. Why should we care about Ukraine? Because I learned that dictators actually tell you exactly what they're going to do. They're very transparent. We saw it. Hamas said they were going to invade Israel. China said they were going to invade Hong Kong. We watched it. Russia said they were going to invade Ukraine. It happened. China says Taiwan is next. We better believe them. Russia said after Ukraine, Poland and the Baltics are next. Those are NATO countries. That puts us at war. This is about preventing war. It's always about preventing war. And this is also a reminder that if Russia wins, China wins. They name themselves unlimited partners. This has been the plan the whole time. But if Ukraine wins, China's not going to go into Taiwan. Now, when Congress tells you, should we support Ukraine? I will first tell you, I don't think we should give cash to any country. I strongly believe that. I don't think we need to put troops on the ground. But I think we need to give them the equipment and ammunition they need to win. And if Biden had dealt with this when Russia surrounded Ukraine, there wouldn't have been a war in the first place. And if Biden had given them the equipment and ammunition they asked for on day one, this war would be over already. Our support to Ukraine is only 3.5% of our defense budget. The Europeans have spent more than that, and they should. It's their neighborhood. 3.5%. Now let's talk about what happened on October 7th. I'm haunted by what happened on October 7th in Israel. The reason why I'm haunted is 5 years ago I gave a speech to the entire world at the United Nations and I said, we know there are maps. These maps are held by Hamas. And what it shows is if they can break through the barrier, this is how they kill as many Jews as fast as they can. And it happened. And this wasn't just murder. This was torture. It has never been that Israel needs America. It's always been that America needs Israel. They're the tip of the spear when it comes to defeating terrorism. They're a bright spot in a tough neighborhood. But when they beheaded those people and they burned those babies, and they raped those girls at that concert and dragged their naked bodies down the streets of Gaza, what did they say? They said, death to Israel, death to America. There would be no Hamas without Iran. There would be no Hezbollah without Iran. There would not be the Houthis without Iran. This is all very calculated. Russia was hitting rock bottom in the war with Ukraine. We know that. Because they had raised the draft age to 65. They were getting drones from Iran and missiles from North Korea. And they had gotten close with Iran. And what happened? On Putin's birthday, October 7th, Hamas invaded Israel. And who's the happiest person in the world today? Putin. Because what did the U.S. do? Move from Ukraine and start looking at Israel. If we were to support Ukraine and Israel, that's 5% of our defense budget. Now, when they talk about securing the border, that should be job number one, without question. We close that border, we secure it, because we are acting right now like it's September 10th, and we better remember what September 12th felt like. It only takes one person. So if we support Ukraine, and if we support Israel, and we support securing the border, that costs us less than 20% of Biden's green subsidies. So it's not that we don't have it. It's about prioritizing how we spend it. And the number one rule is, how do you keep America safe? How do you keep us out of wars? How do you protect our national security? That's what this is all about. And we haven't even talked about the number one national security threat facing America today. China. China has been preparing war with us for years. And that's not me being dramatic. They're already here. They've already infiltrated. They bought 400,000 acres of U.S. soil, most recently near Grand Forks Air Force Base. They bought our largest pork producer. You see that right here in Iowa. They are filling the coffers of universities by stealing our research and spreading Chinese propaganda. There are certain technologies that China uses to build up their military to threaten America. President Biden approved 70% of those last year. And we all got upset with the Chinese spy balloon, right? It was so in our face. What about the fact that 90% of our law enforcement drones in this country are Chinese? So look at all the mini infiltration that's happening. And then you look at how they're building up their military. They now have 500 nuclear warheads. That's 100 more than they had last year. They have the largest naval fleet in the world. They have 370 ships. They'll have 400 ships in 2 years. We won't even have 350 ships in 2 decades. They're doing artificial intelligence. They're doing cyber. They're doing space. They've developed hypersonic missiles. We've barely gotten started. And now China's the lead developer on neurostrike weapons, weapons engineered to change the brain activity of military commanders and segments of the population. That's who we're dealing with. So don't let Biden and Yellen tell you that China is a competitor. Because every day that I was at the United Nations, they never saw us as a competitor. They always saw us as an enemy. We need to start looking at China the way they look at us. So how do we deal with China? First of all, there were two things at the United Nations that Russia, China, and Iran never wanted America to have. They never wanted us to have a strong military, and they never wanted us to be energy independent. Not only will we be energy independent, we will be energy dominant. We should make it a huge economic source for us. That includes biofuels. We need to make sure we are doing as much as we can so that we never go hat in hand to Saudi Arabia and we don't get dirty oil from Venezuela or Iran. We need to produce it here. We should be exporting as much liquefied natural gas as we can. We should be supporting the Keystone Pipeline. We should speed up permitting. And we should work with our producers as partners, not demonize them. And then we'll go to China, and the first thing that we'll do is we'll make sure that they know we're not selling them any more U.S. soil, and we take back the land they've already taken. The next thing we do is we go to our universities, and we say, you either take foreign money or you take American money, but the days of taking both are over, and we'll get that infiltration out of our schools. Then we will blacklist all of that technology that helps China and hurts America. And we have lost more Americans to fentanyl than the Iraq, Afghanistan, and Vietnam wars combined. We lost 75,000 Americans to fentanyl last year. We'll go to China and we'll say, we're going to end all normal trade relations with you until you stop murdering Americans with fentanyl. You watch how fast they move because they need our economy. And then we will build up a strong military. Strong militaries don't start wars. Strong militaries prevent wars. And that doesn't mean you throw a bunch of money to the Department of Defense. You clean up the Department of Defense. It's too slow. It's too bureaucratic. It's gotten too big. And it's focused on the wars of yesterday. We need to make sure we're modernizing. We should be focused on artificial intelligence and cyber and space. We should be getting our men and women the most updated equipment they could possibly have. And we need to start looking at what the threats of the future are. And for goodness sake, you can ask my husband, we have to stop with the gender pronoun classes that are happening in the military. It's demoralizing to them. And get our focus back on track. We can do this. I don't doubt for a second America can be strong again. But we have to stop being reactionary to our adversaries and start letting them know what we expect of them. So we have the answers, domestically and from a foreign policy standpoint. But the first thing we have to do is end this national self-loathing that has taken over our country. The idea that they say America's bad or rotten or racist. I was elected the first female minority governor in history. America's not racist, we're blessed. Our kids need to know to love America. They need to be saying the Pledge of Allegiance when they start school every day. You know, 5 months ago, I dropped my husband Michael off at 4 a.m. for another year-long deployment. And I watched him and 230 soldiers pick up their two duffel bags of belongings to go to a country they'd never been, all in the name of protecting America. They're willing to sacrifice their lives and their families because they still believe in this amazing experiment that is America. So if they're willing to fight for us there, shouldn't we be willing to fight for America here? Because we have a country to save. But in order to do that, we have to realize more hard truths. Republicans have lost the last 7 out of 8 popular votes for president. That is nothing to be proud of. We should want to win the majority of America. But the only way we're going to do that is leave the negativity and the drama behind us and focus with a new generational leader who can look at the threats of the future and get real solutions going for us. Now, this is another hard truth. I believe Donald Trump was the right president at the right time. I agree with a lot of his policies. I had a great working relationship with him when I was in the administration. But the truth is, rightly or wrong, chaos follows him. Chaos follows, you know him, right? Chaos follows him. And we can't have a country in disarray and a world on fire and be dealing with 4 years of chaos. We won't survive it. And more importantly, if you look at any general election polls that they're putting out there, Biden and Trump are head-to-head. On a good day, he's up by 2 points. You look at my numbers in that same general election poll, we're up 10 to 13 points over Biden. So this isn't just about the presidency. This is about governorships up and down the ticket, Senate seats, House seats. This is about really redirecting our entire country to get back on track. That's what we want. That's what we need. But we've got it. That's going to require a lot of courage. Courage from every single one of us in this room. Courage for me to run. And courage for every one of you to realize, don't complain about what happens in a general election if you don't play in this caucus. Because it matters. We can fix this. America has an amazing ability to self-correct. Sometimes we have to hit rock bottom to know where up is. We're there. Now we just need to start looking up. Do you remember when you were growing up? How simple life was? How safe it felt? It was about faith, family, and country. Your parents raised you to be responsible individuals. You went to school and you learned what you needed to be successful. You went to church and you found your faith and your conscience. Don't you want that again? Because we could have that again. But we've got to all say we're going to write this ship and get it done. You know, when I was first announced, they asked me why I was running. And I said, my parents came here 50 years ago to an America that was strong and proud and full of opportunities. I want them to know that country. I'm doing this for my husband, Michael, and his military brothers and sisters. They need to know their sacrifice matters. They need to know that we love our country. I'm doing this for my daughter, who just got married, and I saw how hard it was for her and her husband to buy a home. And I'm doing this for my son, who's a senior in college, and I am tired of watching him write papers of things he doesn't believe in just to get an A. That's not us. That's not America. And for the first time, 81% of Americans don't think their kids are going to live as good of a life as we can. I'm not okay with that. You shouldn't be okay with that. We do have a country to save. But I'll make you this promise now. you join with me in these caucuses, we will finish this, and I promise you, our best days are yet to come. Thank you very much. God bless you. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you very much. And y'all have been so nice to listen to me. Now we're going to turn the mics on you. We're going to open it up for questions. There's nothing I won't answer. You may not like my answer, but there's nothing I won't answer. So we've got two of us. There's two people with microphones. If you hold your hand up, they will mind. Yes, sir.
Hello, how are you? Yes.
He won't give you the mic, okay, because he thinks you're going to
The Inflation Reduction Act, the very misname, it was all about these Green New Deals, and they spent trillions of dollars on this stuff, including the electric car mandate. You're an accountant. You understand about cost-benefit analysis. The cost for these environmental programs, especially in electric cars, and as you pointed out, doing away with coal, it's a very high cost with a very, very low benefit. It seems like they don't understand accounting, and they certainly don't understand science. Unless we stop, India and China from putting all these coal-burning plants in, we just don't make that much difference at all. So I'd like to know what your opinion is about the electric car mandate and the environmental issues and all that stuff.
Okay, there's a lot there that we're going to go back to. So first of all, let's just talk about the environment and then go to the... Don't we all want clean water? Don't we all want clean air? Don't we want a world for our kids to have going forward? So let's take it off the table that there's anyone who doesn't care about the environment. We all care about it. Regardless of party, we should all care about it. But if we care about it, then let's be honest. And I was at the United Nations, and I pulled us out of the Paris Climate Agreement. And the reason I pulled us out was not because I don't care about the environment, but because what they were trying to get us to do and what Obama got us into was we had to put all these regulations to say we were going to cut emissions a certain amount when we're one of the good ones. And what did countries like China do? You know what their plan was? Literally, in the Paris Climate Agreement, that they would deal with it in 10 years. And I can promise you 10 years will never come for China. If we really care about the environment, we have to go to China and India and say, you have got to cut your emissions. That's the best way that we could do it. You get with all of the other friendly countries and you say, this is what you have to do and this is how you do it. That's the biggest thing we could do when it comes to the environment. The Inflation Reduction Act, we will reverse all of Biden's green subsidies because all you're doing is hurting American businesses. But it's not just the subsidies, it's all the stimulus money. So you look at the Inflation Reduction Act, and it tells everybody, Biden says, I want everybody to have an electric car by 2030. First of all, we don't all want electric cars. Secondly, they're incredibly expensive. But we don't even have the infrastructure if that were to happen. And I'm not just talking about charging stations. That's one of the things. But electric cars are actually very heavy. Our roads and bridges couldn't withstand everybody driving an electric car. They're not that strong. It was never meant for that. So we better futuristically look about what we're going to do with electric cars before you go and mandate that all these people have to buy them. So that's the first problem. But the other thing is with the other subsidies. When you look at that, where do 70% of the batteries for electric cars come from? China. So you just gave a massive amount of money to a country that hates us, that's putting up a spy center off the shores in Cuba. It's not even smart. The CHIPS Act, do y'all remember that? I strongly oppose the CHIPS Act. Do I think we need chips? Absolutely. But if you saw what was in that bill, it gave American money, it gave American companies money to manufacture chips because we needed to become less dependent on China. You know what it didn't do? It didn't stop those American companies from manufacturing in China. So now you just gave them a bunch of money. They're making money in China, and now they're making money here. It's about being smart with taxpayer dollars. It's our money. I'm going to add one more thing to that. Do Do you know 70% of federal employees right now are still working from home 3 years after COVID? Do you know 75% of most of our federal agency buildings are empty? We're paying for that. That's our money. We have got to get back to understanding the value of a dollar and that it's taxpayer dollars. And you don't go and flush out all this money and think that you're going to get something better. It just hasn't been well thought out. So it's not just the Inflation Reduction Act. There's a lot there that we need to pull back. Yes, sir.
You mentioned China owns a lot of American land, about 400,000 acres or something. How do we, you said we're going to take that back. How does that happen?
On a national security level. So what we do know is certain ones, they're running cables underneath. We should go in, and if we can show that it is a national security threat to America, we should go and take that land back. We've got to be smart about this. This is one of those things where you've got to go and understand what they're doing. It's not for us to have to, I mean, they should have to prove that there's nothing going on. But we know that there's cables running underneath there. And when we see that, you should automatically take that land back because that's a violation of our national security. That's how we do that. I lost y'all wherever you are. Yes, sir.
Well, thank you, Governor, for protecting and defending and fighting for our country at the United Nations when you were ambassador. And the Venezuelan dictator Maduro is planning on invading his oil-rich neighbor, Guyana, like Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait. What would you do right now to prevent that?
The problem, even with that, is look at what Biden did for Venezuela. So Biden just lifted sanctions because Maduro promised to have fair elections. That's so ridiculous. Like, stop believing dictators. They're always going to lie to you. And now Biden's going, oh, maybe we need to put those sanctions back on. But when you look at what's happening with Guyana, the same thing is you've got all of this is happening because no one fears America anymore. They would never have done that if we were strong. They're only doing that because they don't think America has the stomach to do anything. So to me, what I would do, the way we would deal with that, is you have to put heavy sanctions on Venezuela, and you've got to get the rest of our allies to do the same thing. If they don't have the money, they can't go and invade Guyana. Yes, ma'am.
Thanks. I feel like one of the biggest problems with government right now is the chaos in the Republican Party in Congress. So do you have any ideas for how to rein that in and actually have them get something done in Congress?
It's an issue because we know if you put down legislation, if anybody puts down legegislation, everybody wants to know whose it is before they decide to support it, right? That's how we know we've hit rock bottom. You will see me do exactly what I did as governor, but on a federal level. So when I became governor, the legislature, I mean, you remember what I told you, they were all mad at me for making them vote on record. So they were not happy when I became governor. Most of them were elected when I was 7. And I was the first female, so, oh my God, it's a girl. You know, it was like not a good situation. But you don't push your way through. You set the tone at the top. So the first thing I did is I replaced the head of every agency, whether they were good or not, because I wanted to freshen it up. The second thing is I sent people into every agency to clean it up, pull down old regs, pull down bureaucracy, get rid of problem children. You have to do that if you have a bureaucracy. You've got to clean it up. The next thing I did was I gave them 90-day benchmarks. It was to get them mission-focused. They had to show the taxpayers a return on investment. So they got used to working within their mission again. Remember, government was intended to secure the rights and freedoms of the people. It was never meant to be all things to all people. Then we focused on the fact that they were spending the money in their agency because they were worried they wouldn't get the same amount of money the next year. So we went and put all of their spending online for the entire, all the taxpayers to see. And we incentivize them to start giving money back to the taxpayers. And magic happened because they started to compete against each other. And then after I did that, setting the tone, I controlled what I could control. A president should control their agencies immediately to clean up that bureaucracy. And then I went to the legislature, and I gave them a couple of easy things to do so that they could remember what it was like to win again. And then I started giving harder things and harder things. That's what we're going to have to do with Congress. We've got to remind them what it means to work again, what it means to win again, and what it means to stop getting on TV and peacocking and instead actually get to work for the American people. But it will start with the tone at the top. I will do it first. I will show them what's expected. I will include all of you as I do it. I communicated constantly with the taxpayers of South Carolina to let them know, and I would call out Republicans and Democrats if I saw something wrong. And so the pressure came from the outside in. You know, you talk about, people always say, well, how can you get them to do term limits? They're never going to vote term limits for themselves. But the way I will do it is you will have a Haley term limit pledge. So when they file for office, incumbent or challenger, they can either sign it or not sign it. But I give that information to you so that you can make the decision based on that. It's just how do you put as much information in the hands of a taxpayer as you possibly can so that they can make good decisions. That's how we'll deal with it going forward. And we'll get them working again. Oh, hi, sweet girl.
Would you like to do a good job?
How old are you? 7? So are you in 2nd grade? 1st grade. I love that, and I like your jacket. So for fun, before I ran for president, because we don't have a whole lot of fun right now, before I ran for president, there were two things I loved. I love to go running. I was a runner, and so I would run. Now I have to sleep instead of run, so I don't get to do that. And the second thing is, my favorite thing, and our families, we used to have Haley family fun nights. And now my kids are older, and so they're not at home. But my husband and I would always sit on the couch, get under a blanket, and watch a good movie. That's still my very favorite thing, so that's what we do for fun. And I love music. Yes, sir.
How are you doing, Governor?
Good, thank you.
So everything that I've heard from you, I really like. I'm a little nervous, and it's hard for me to trust folks these days, especially folks that are in our government and running for office, right, especially president. So I've heard a lot of people say that you're running just to run as President Trump's VP. Would you run, or if asked, what would you say if he asked you, hey, would you be my VP?
I will tell you, I don't play for second. I've never played for second my entire life. I'm not going to start right now.
You said Social Security would be bankrupt in 10 years. What is your plan to rectify the situation that is going on right now? That everybody that has paid into Social Security will be able to collect that when they reach retirement age?
It's a great question, because every other candidate in the race has said they're not going to touch any Social Security or Medicare issues. So that means you're going to go into office, serve 8 years, and leave it bankrupt for the next person? I am telling you, we have to have entitlement reform. We have to do it. We have to get in front of it. But that doesn't mean you take away from people who have been promised. America should always keep her promises. So you should have no fear that anything's going to happen. The way we do it is we go to those like my kids in their 20s, those new coming into the system. We go to them and we say, the rules are going to change for you. So we change retirement age for them to reflect life expectancy. Instead of cost of living increases, we do increases based on inflation. We limit benefits on the wealthy. You can ask a Bernie Marcus or a Ken Langone. They don't want to get the checks. There's a lot of people who don't want the checks. We limit the benefits on the wealthy. And then we expand Medicare Advantage plans, which seniors love because it's competition and it lowers the cost of health care. That's how we will deal with it. And let's also remember, we'll grow the economy. You know, as governor, I sold South Carolina, and I was proud to sell her. It was all about how could we make our businesses more money by selling their products out. You've heard me talk about China. A lot of our farmers here and around the country sell to China, right? Don't worry about that, because the focus should be not that you just stop selling to China, but that we go to our ally, India, and say, this is what we need you to buy from us. This is what we can do. You partner Australia, India, South Korea, Japan, the Philippines. India gave themselves $1 billion stimulus to become less dependent on China. Japan did the same thing. They are all looking for ways to do business with other countries besides China. We would do the same thing. So we would grow our economy. We would make sure we build up our energy system. But yes, we will do entitlement reforms, but not in a way that you should fear, but in a way that our kids can actually have something when it becomes their time. Yes, ma'am.
I've heard you talk a lot about foreign policy, education, like all of those things, but can you tell us a little bit more about your vision for healthcare reform, bringing those a little bit down to size for us?
How can we be the best country in the world with the most expensive healthcare in the world? It's really unbelievable. Michael and I, we take care of my parents. They live with us. They're 87 and 89. When my mom was in the hospital, I remember the nurse coming up to her trying to give her two Tylenol. And my mom was like, I don't need it. And she said, honey, you might as well take it. You're paying for it anyway. When we got the bill, no one talked to us about the bill. No one gave us any idea what to expect. We just got a bill that we were supposed to be responsible for. And the fact that that bill was negotiated between the insurance company and the hospital without us involved at all is criminal. So the way we're going to deal with healthcare is we're going to open up the whole thing. The first you have to do is look at where all the warts are. So we're going to make it all transparent, from the hospitals to the doctor's offices to the pharmaceutical companies to the PBMs, the managers in the middle, to the insurance companies. If we just dealt with the insurance companies alone, our healthcare costs would be cut in half. But let's look at all of them. Let's make them show us everything. They can't complain because we're picking on every industry, not just one of them. And let's see where the warts are. And let's get the patient out of the back seat and start saying, how do we make them the driver? So think about when something happens to your car. You go to the mechanic, and the mechanic says, I can do a temporary fix, and it's going to cost you this much money. Or I can give you the real fix, and it's going to cost you this much money. But you decide. That's where we have to get to, is I want you to decide what you're going to get. And the only way you get that is if you have options. So first, we're going to open it up and look at the pricing. The second thing is doctors don't give you those 10 tests because they want to. They do it for the 90% chance they're going to get sued. You have to have tort reform because that's what's going to bring the cost of health care down. We did that in South Carolina. We've got to do it all over the country. The next thing is there is something called certificate of need. Certificate of need is something where if you notice a hospital sitting on this corner, there's no hospital for X number of miles, right? Because of certificate of need. They're protected. They do it for nursing homes. They do it for surgical centers. That's what they do to avoid competition. When I was growing up in our family business, my mom used to always say the best thing that could happen is if our competition went across the street, because we would always be at the top of our game on service and we would keep our costs down. I eliminated certificate of need in South Carolina so that we had competition among all those. Those hospitals should be fighting for you, and they will fight for you by raising the amount of service, lowering the costs, and giving you options. You should have that. These are all very doable things, but we have to do it. You look right now, people are getting their medicines from Canada because it's too expensive to get it here. No one understands their insurance. No one understands how to deal with it. And so we need to open it up. It's a priority. And that includes the fact that mental health care is not included in any of it. And we right now, if you look at the mental health issues that we have, one in three individuals in our country have a mental health issue. But if treated, they can live a perfectly normal life. The problem is we don't have enough therapists. And if, aside from the therapist, we don't have enough mental health centers. And if you don't get treated, you could likely fall into an addiction. We don't have enough addiction centers. And if you happen to be lucky enough to get one of those, insurance doesn't cover any of it. We have to right the ship when it comes to healthcare. And so you hear them talking about, oh, well, what do you think about Obamacare? What do you think? Stop piecemealing it. That's not the answer. The answer is you have to acknowledge you have a problem. You have to acknowledge there are a lot of players who are a part of that problem. And transparency is a beautiful thing. When you open things up, the answers come to the surface. That's what we'll do. One more question. Make it a great one. Where are you, Andrew? Are you?
Right over here.
Hello?
Yes.
We do really appreciate the fact that you came to Sioux City, and we really do appreciate the fact that you're giving us honest answers.
Of course.
So now I'm looking for an honest answer from this one.
Okay.
What percentage do you need to win in Iowa on January 15 in order to be satisfied?
Are all of you going to caucus for me? Look, the way I look at Iowa, get used to this face. I have been here so many times, and it's cold, y'all. It's cold. My southern skin, like, this is how much I am working to get your vote. I am going to keep coming back. I'm not giving up on Iowa. And right now, we are in second place in Iowa, second place in New Hampshire, second place in South Carolina, and we're going to keep on pushing. The momentum is on our side, but I want to earn every vote. The way I look at it is we just need to have a good showing in Iowa. I don't think that means we have to win necessarily, but I think that means we have to have a good showing. This is my first caucus, so I have never dealt with a caucus before, but we know that we need to have precinct chairs. We know we need to have all the chairs of everything, and we've got our grassroots group, and you're going to have a card on your chair that if you decide you want to caucus for us or volunteer for us, we'll do that. But it's not, I'm not one that's going to say, I'd be okay with this percentage. I want all of you. I'm not going to stop until I go and fight for everybody. We've got a ton of town halls we're doing over the next few days. It's touching every person that I need to touch. Did that get to the heart of your answer? What were you looking for? not the percentage, but what's behind the question that you're trying to ask?
People keep dropping out, and there will be fewer options.
Absolutely. I see what you're saying. Okay, that's a different question. See, that's what you should have asked me. Okay, so the first thing I'll tell you is the debate process has actually been one that's kind of brought things to a close. We started with 13 candidates. First debate, there were 8. The second debate, there were 7. The third debate, there were 5. This last debate, there were 4. There will be a debate in Iowa, I understand, and there's going to be 3. Right? So I think you've got, you know, 3 major people that are going to go into Iowa, and I think after Iowa, one's going to drop. And then I think you're going to have a play with me and Trump in New Hampshire, and then we're going to go to my home state of South Carolina, and we're going to take it. And then we're on to Super Tuesday. We have a country to save. I'm not going to stop until we do that. So I want to thank you for the time that you gave, but I will tell you this. When I ran against that longest-serving legislator I told you about, people laughed at me. And I got to work, and I earned their support, and we won. When I ran for governor, I ran against the lieutenant governor, an attorney general, a very popular congressman, and a state senator. I was Nikki Haley, I had 3% in the polls. I had the least amount of money. But I worked South Carolina like no one else, and we won. When I got to the United Nations, they said I didn't have enough experience. And I got to work and took the kick me sign off of our backs. I have been underestimated in everything I've ever done. And it's a blessing because it makes me scrappy. No one's going to outwork me in this race. No one's going to outsmart me in this race because I do think we have a country to save. So if you like what I had to say today, go tell 10 people. Tell them, let them know what we're saying. Fill out this card to caucus or volunteer for us. Spread the word because they trust their friends and their family more than anybody else. So go out and tell them to go to NikkiHaley.com and volunteer, join us, or come to a town hall and hear what we have to say. If you don't like what I had to say today, just don't say anything and don't tell anyone you were here. God bless you. Thank you so much.